Well, good morning and welcome to today's worship service. We apologize for the technical difficulties, and I really think that the enemy's at work today, not only through the weather, but even through technology. The past several weeks, everything's worked perfectly until today and the day that we really needed it, but we are going to continue to press on and just be faithful to the Lord. We're so grateful that you've joined us online. We've only got a couple of daredevils that are here with us today, but for the rest of you, we're thankful that you're joining us online. Just a couple of announcements. First off, I just want to say to be safe to everyone out there. I know the weather continues to press in. I'm glad that most of you chose to stay home today because the sidewalks are already slick and a lot of slick places on the road, and it's only going to get worse. So we just pray that everyone stays warm and stays safe today. Just a couple of prayer requests. I'm going to open in prayer here in a few moments, but we're going to be praying. I want you to be praying for just all those that are sick in our community. A lot of folks sick with all sorts of different things, with respiratory infections and strep and so much more. But also COVID. We know that there's been a spread of COVID here in the area and several folks in our community. So we just want to be praying for one another. I know there's just lots of different requests, so we want to remember those, and I'll lift those up here in just a few moments. I know all of us have some unspoken prayer requests that we could mention, and that you may have. You can even send your requests there online so others can see it and be praying for it. Also, we want to pray for the lost, those that don't know Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. So let's just be praying for all those requests. And before I do pray, I want to mention just some birthdays. I know that today is Evan Smith's birthday, so we want to wish him a happy birthday today. We know that Jerry and Betty Vaughn celebrated 55 years of marriage this past week. Praise the Lord for that. Well, what an amazing celebration that is, and we celebrate with them. Also, Jared Allen had a birthday this past week. And also, I know that Ben Gilbert, Kanan Browning, and even Blake Combs all celebrated birthday. So a big happy birthday to all of you, and a happy anniversary to Jerry and Betty. So as we continue the service, let's go to our Father in a word of prayer. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for this day that you've given us. God, we thank you for the ways that you pour out your blessings upon us over and over. God, we thank you just for this church, and even though that we're not here present, God, we are together in different places. The same Spirit lives inside of each and every one of us, and we're part of the same family, God. So I just pray that you speak to us today, you encourage us, you challenge us. God, we lift up these different requests that have been made, that may be made online, or that others may have in their heart, even the unspoken requests, some of the sickness that I've mentioned. Dear Father, I pray that you would work and move in a mighty way. God, lots of sickness, especially the coronavirus continuing to spread. We pray for all those that have it. Pray that you keep those others safe that don't have it. Pray for symptoms wouldn't be very great, very strong, and that we could just continue to press on past this. God, those that are struggling with certain depression or anxiety, those that are struggling with loss, mourning loss. God, we just pray for all the brokenness among us, all those that are struggling for different reasons. You know, God, better than we do, and you're able to do something. You're the great healer. You're the great physician. We also pray for the lost, those that don't know your Son, Jesus, as Lord and Savior. God, speak to them. I pray that we'd be faithful in sharing the gospel with them, that they'd be convicted of their sins, and they'd come to know your Son, Jesus, as Lord and Savior. In your Son's name we pray, amen. Now Brother Greg is going to lead us in one song, and then we've got a special song after Greg gets done.
I love the old cross where the Oh. I surrender
all.
Surrender all. Thank you.
Thank you, Jotham, for that and for your obedience. I pray that we would all just surrender all to Christ and be obedient to Him. And it actually fits really well with today's message as we continue our three-part series through the Lord's Prayer. And I think it's not a coincidence that we're having so many struggles and technicalities and difficulties this morning, because I truly believe today's message, that the enemy doesn't want me to preach it, but also doesn't want us to hear it as well. It's a message focusing on God and His kingdom and His will and His glory. And that's exactly what our enemy does not want. He wants to continue to rule and reign and do anything that he can to hold on to that. We're going to continue, as I said, our series called Lord, Teach Us to Pray. That's the name of our series, Lord, Teach Us to Pray. But today's message is simply titled, The Heart of Prayer. The Heart of Prayer. We're going to be in Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 through 10. The verses and everything is going to be on the screen behind me and the different points. But if you have a copy of God's Word and you want to start turning there, you can go ahead and do that. Last week, we started this three-part series off talking just about who the Lord's Prayer is addressed to. And who is that? It's to our Heavenly Father. And just a reminder that as we come to prayers, we come to come before God, that we pray to a God who is our loving Heavenly Father. He's a good God. He's a loving God. And He wants to spend time with us. And I think that should change our perspective, that there's a God that we go to and we pray that truly wants to be in relationship, wants to spend time with us, and ultimately He has made a way for us to be in relationship with Him as we are born again into God's family, but we are also adopted into God's eternal family. So this week, we're going to move beyond who the prayer is written to, or who the prayer is addressed to, and we're going to focus on the requests that Jesus makes to His Heavenly Father. As you read through the Lord's Prayer, you're going to see that Jesus makes seven requests. Seven requests to His Heavenly Father. Now, the first three are what we would call vertical requests. These deal with requests between Him and His Heavenly Father. And then the last four, we're going to see next week, Lord willing, that the final four is more of a horizontal prayer request for Himself, prayer request for others. And interestingly, the Ten Commandments, a lot of you know this, the Ten Commandments are structured in the same way, because the first four of the Ten Commandments is about our vertical relationship with God. Know the gods before me, no graven image, don't take the Lord's name in vain, keep the Sabbath holy. And then, so the first four is about the vertical, our relationship with God. The final six is about our relationship with others. Don't steal, don't murder, don't commit adultery, and the list goes on and on. So that's kind of a similar way to the Lord's Prayer is structured here, that Jesus sets it up like that. So before Jesus makes any sort of personal prayer request or even prayer request for others, we're going to see that Jesus first focuses on His Heavenly Father and making requests relating to Him and His glory and His will and His kingdom. And this is something that we need to take note of. Because remember, the Lord's Prayer is not just a prayer that we recite and we just say it over and over, although we can, but it gives a model for us. So when we talk about the heart of prayer, we need to realize that prayer begins with God. And later at the end, we're going to see that prayer also ends with God. So with that being said, and that set up, I'm going to read for us Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 through 10. And I'm going to stop us right in the middle of the Lord's Prayer, and we'll pick that up next week. After this manner, this is Jesus speaking. He says, therefore, pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. So just in these two verses here, we're going to find three things, three ways that we should pray to God for. Three ways to pray. The first one is this, is that we should pray for God's name to be hallowed. We should pray for God's name to be hallowed. You're going to see my points kind of follow right along with the Lord's Prayer. But what's important is to try to understand what is Jesus saying when he makes these requests to his Heavenly Father. So the first one, we should pray that God's name be hallowed. Because verse 9, the second part, what does it say? Hallowed be thy name. Well, what does this word hallowed mean? Because it's kind of this churchy word, but it's also an archaic English word that we don't really use except when we quote the Lord's Prayer. But it's a word that's used to translate the Greek word hagiazo, which is to make something holy. So when Jesus is praying this prayer here, makes this request, he's literally saying, Heavenly Father, let your name be made holy. Father, let your name be made holy. But we've got to stop here and ask, well, can God's name be made more holy? And I would say no, because when we look at Scripture, when we look especially in the Old Testament, we're going to see that God's name is already holy. I mean, Psalm 111:9 says this, He has sent redemption to His people. He has commanded His covenant forever. Holy and awesome is His name. And so the very last phrase right there, holy and awesome is His name. And we could look at other verses, but it makes us the Bible makes it clear that God's name is already holy. So the request, I think when Jesus says, hallowed be thy name, it's not that God would somehow make His name more or less holy, because it already is. His name is holy. The request, I think, is that Jesus asking God to act in such a way that He visibly demonstrates His holiness and His glory. That God would act in such a way that people would see and notice that God truly is holy, and they would ascribe that holiness to Him, that the people, when they see who God truly is, they would give Him the reverence, the respect, the honor, the worship that God truly desires. This is Jesus' desire. This is His first request, His first desire, saying, God, I pray that people would know that You truly are holy, that You are good, that people would glorify God's name. And it's important for us to know this when the Old Testament, but also in the Bible, we see that anytime the name of someone is used, it's basically to reference that person. Therefore, to hallow or honor God's name is, in essence, to honor and hallow God Himself. And so what we need to realize is when we look through the Bible from the beginning to the end, we don't always talk about this, but this is so important. So if you're multitasking, or maybe you're scrolling through Facebook, I want you to come back and I want you to focus on this truth right here. It's so very important. Is that God's primary concern, we see from the Bible from beginning to end, God's primary concern is for His own name and His own glory. God is concerned about His name, His glory, His renown. And so when God acts, He is acting on behalf of His own glory. Look at Psalm 25:11. The psalmist writes and says, For Your name's sake, O Lord, pardon my iniquity, for it is great. The psalmist knew that God acts according to His glory, so he said, hey, pardon my iniquity so that Your name would be glorified. God, that's his prayer. And God's word even says that we were created for God's glory. Look at Isaiah 43:7. We don't think about this. We don't like to think about this. It says, Everyone who is called by my name, whom I have created, listen to this, whom I have created for my glory, I have formed him. Yes, I have made him. God created us for His own glory. And some of you hear that, and when I first started to become aware of this truth, this foundational truth, it made me a little uncomfortable. And why did it make me uncomfortable? Because it somehow seems to make God to be arrogant or boastful or very self-centered, like, you need to be all about me. I created you because you want to be about me. But if we stop and think about this, who else would we want God to be all about? Who else would we want God to focus on their glory? Certainly not mine. Certainly not yours. I mean, that's even laughing. Why? If God made it was all about us and our glory, then he wouldn't be God. And not about any sort of created thing, because he is the creator. Who else would we want God to ascribe glory and to be all about? So we see that God is all about his name, all about his glory. He created us for his own glory. So therefore, if that's true, then we as his people, what should we do? We should seek out his glory. Just as Jesus stood, he's praying, God, hallowed be your name. God, I pray that your name would be glorified. And so look at 1 Corinthians 10:31. This is what Paul exactly says. Paul realized that God was all about his glory. And so he knew that one thing that we should do is to ascribe glory to God. Look here, 1 Corinthians 10:31. Should show up on the screen here. Therefore, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, doesn't matter what you do, whatever you're doing, Paul says to do all for the glory of God. And in this series on prayer, we could even say, however you pray, pray according to the glory. Pray for the glory of God. And this is so important in my own life, thinking about my own testimony, my own journey. And it was in my early days in college when God led me to Psalm 115:1, which says, not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name be the glory, because of your love and faithfulness. And I realized in the early parts of my life, and even I still struggle with this now, that I strive to somehow glorify David's name. I want to exalt my name. I want others to talk about me, say good things about me. But then I realized, you know what? It's God who deserves the glory. That's the glory we seek, is God's glory, not our own glory. And this is what Jesus is praying as he starts those prayers. And I starts his prayer, and I think we should pray like this. We pray, begin saying, God, I want your name to be hallowed. I want your name to be glorified. But don't miss this. I talked about God seeking his own glory, and going to all that he does is to bring glory to his name. That glory that he has for his name does not minimize, nor does it diminish his love for us. And I think it actually increases it, because God exalts his name. Some of the ways that he exalts his name is by showering his love and his mercy and his grace on us. As he does that, as he's good to us, as he pours out his love, as he sent his son to die on the cross for us, he is exalting his name. Praise be to God. And I can't help it. So often, maybe we don't pray, or maybe we don't pray very effectively, so to speak, is because we don't, instead of wanting God's name to be glorified, we want our own names to be glorified. Oftentimes our prayers, and think about it, some of the things you pray, so often our prayers are motivated by selfish or self-glorifying motives. And I think when we pray, first and foremost, God, I pray that your name be hallowed, it kind of sets that, our focus and our mentality, lays the foundation for what's going to be prayed next. And so the first request helps us to make sure that our heart and our posture of prayer is at the right, at the very beginning. It's foundational. We don't just jump into requests saying, God, help me with this, help so-and-so with this. But we say, you know what, I'm going to focus on your glory first and foremost. We acknowledge his holiness. We acknowledge God's glory. And so what does this look like? It looks like coming to our Heavenly Father and saying, God, I pray that you would honor, you would worship, glorify your name. God, I pray that the church, I pray that we as a church and we as a family, we would exalt and glorify your name in all that we do. Father, I pray that all that we do would just bring glory and honor to you. Father, help me to make my request. God, help me whatever I pray after this. God, I pray that it would glorify your name. So let's take last week's message and let's make sure we pair these together and we don't miss this. Is God a loving and heaven? Is our God our loving Heavenly Father who loves us, wants to spend time with us, and is approachable because of Jesus Christ, that one mediator, the great high priest? Yes. But he is also holy. He is also holy other. And so we come, yes, as a child to a father, but yet we also come with respect and honor and reverence to our Heavenly Father. So number one, we should pray for God's name to be hallowed. Number two, we should pray for God's kingdom to come. Right? It says, your kingdom come, thy kingdom come. So what is this kingdom? Why would Jesus pray that the kingdom would come? Well, when we talk about the kingdom of God, God's kingdom, it's not just a geographical location. Because sometimes we think of a kingdom, we think, oh, the kingdom of Saudi Arabia, the kingdom, it's over there, some other place. It's not necessarily a geographical location, a place, as much as it is a dominion. It is a rule and reign. So think about this. When it comes to a kingdom, what's the most important part of a kingdom? It's the king. You can't have a kingdom without the king. And so when we think about the kingdom of God, who is the king? The king is Jesus. He's the King of kings. He's the Lord of lords. When Jesus came to this earth, his focus was to do what? To bring about the kingdom of God. His preaching said the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God is near. He was focused on the kingdom of God. So therefore, here's how I understand the kingdom of God. It's anywhere the rule and reign of Jesus is present. The kingdom of God is anywhere where the rule and reign of King Jesus is present. So let's think about heaven. In heaven, the rule and reign of Jesus is fully established. So the kingdom of God is in heaven, yes, but also it's present in the followers, those who have submitted to the lordship, the kingship of Jesus here on this earth. That's why Jesus said the kingdom of God will be in you or within you. Because the rule and reign for those of us that are followers of Jesus, the rule and reign of God is inside of us because we've submitted to King Jesus. So through Jesus' finished work on the cross and through his resurrection, he inaugurated the kingdom of God. And when he inaugurated that kingdom of God, it was like he planted the seed of the kingdom. And Jesus even uses that parable, that story about the sower that went out and he planted the seed. And then talked about the mustard seed and how it was the smallest of the seeds. But yet when he planted it, that mustard seed grew and grew. It was gradual, sometimes happening overnight, but it continued to grow into this beautiful tree, this huge tree, that the birds of the air would come and land in his branches, and the animals would come and be under the shade. But he also uses the example of the yeast, and how the baker just took a little piece of yeast and put it in the flour and the rest of the dough, and that dough or that yeast just spread to the rest of the dough. And Jesus saying, this is like the kingdom of God. When he came, when he died and rose again, it's like he planted that seed. It's like he planted that dough. And ever since that day, for the past 2,000 plus years, the kingdom continues to grow. It continues to expand. And ultimately, nothing will stop the kingdom of God from spreading. And so now, therefore, because Jesus inaugurated the kingdom of God and it is present, we now see two kingdoms at work, two kingdoms at play in this world right now simultaneously. We have the kingdom of God, and we have the kingdom of Satan, or sometimes called the kingdom of this world. Those two kingdoms that are side by side. The kingdom of God, what is it characterized by? Peace and joy and love. The abundant life, Jesus calls it. And what's Satan's kingdom characterized by? By brokenness, by hate, by destruction, and not love of God, but love of man and love of the world. And you see these two kingdoms existing here on earth together, but they are at odds with each other. And you cannot be in both kingdoms at once. You're either in God's kingdom or you are in the kingdom of Satan. You just can't be in both. You're in either God's kingdom or the kingdom of Satan. Now think about oil and water. You take a glass You pour some water, you pour some oil in there, and you can see a clear difference between the two. And I don't care how many times you can take that glass or you put a lid on it and you shake it up, it might seem like it's there together, but ultimately that oil and water, they're going to separate because they're two completely different things. And that's the same way in the kingdom of God, where you're either in the kingdom of God or you're in the kingdom of Satan. And it's a reminder for us as we're talking about the kingdom and as we're living here in America, and I love America. Living abroad, it made me appreciate so many things about the United States. But we need to be reminded, brothers and sisters, that the United States is not the kingdom of God. Is the kingdom of God present here within the U.S.? Yes. But we have hopes for the full consummation, the full the finality of God's kingdom when Jesus Christ comes. But until then, we are sojourners. We are aliens. We are foreigners here, and we must not get comfortable. Brothers and sisters, we must not get comfortable here. And so is it possible that we don't pray for God's kingdom to come? Maybe because we just don't realize that prayer or fully understand it. But also, is it that we don't pray that prayer and pray it earnestly because we're so at home in this world? That we get so caught up in this world that we don't long for the kingdom of God to come in its fullness? Because what we need to realize with the kingdom of God, we live in the now, the already, but not yet. The already, but not yet. Someday when Jesus Christ returns, he'll eventually destroy Satan and fully establish the kingdom of God, and the new heaven and the new earth will be here. And the kingdom of God will be fully established for all eternity. And that's something to give us hope. That's something for us to look forward to. And so now we've got to ask this question. How does one enter into the kingdom of God? And I'd say simply, it's through conversion. How do we enter the kingdom of God? Through conversion. It's by grace, through faith. It's through faith and repentance, God's word tells us. Look at Romans 10:9. Should show up on the screen here for us. Paul says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, what is that? That is that. That's, to me, that's repentance. That's turning from being your own Lord, your own God, turning to submission to the authority and to the Lordship of God. So it's confessing with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, that Jesus is King. And also believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. He says if you do that, you'll be saved. See, sometimes we talk about Jesus as our Savior, and Jesus is our Savior. And this verse is telling us how to do it. But so often we focus just on faith in what he has done for us. And that's true. But it's also a submission to his lordship, confessing him as Lord, following Jesus, leaving our former life and leaving all this behind us and taking up our cross and following Jesus, submitting to his lordship, repenting of our sins. And so through our conversion, when the Spirit comes to indwell us and we become born again, we become new creatures, new creation, God's word says that when we do that, our allegiance switches from sin and Satan in this world to then to King Jesus. And look at what Paul says in the book of Colossians, chapter 1, verses 13. He says, he has delivered us, those of us that are followers of Jesus Christ, he says, he has delivered us from the power of darkness. That's the kingdom of Satan. And what has he done? He's conveyed us or transferred us or put us into the kingdom of the Son of his love. You see that? It's a switching from the kingdom of Satan and darkness to the kingdom of light and the kingdom of God. And that happens through faith, happens through conversion in Jesus Christ. See, the request for God's kingdom to come, and it is a prayer for people to enter the kingdom through conversion. So when we say, God, I pray that your kingdom would come, we're praying that God would bring about conversion of those in our lives, that the kingdom of God would spread, that rule and reign of God would spread into the hearts of those in our family, to our friends, to those in our community, that the rule and reign would move. It's a prayer for the lost. It's a prayer for missionaries. It's a prayer for church planters. It's a prayer for boldness. It's a prayer for faithfulness for us to share the gospel with those that are around us. And ultimately, the prayer for God's kingdom to come ultimately is a prayer that God would return and fully establish his kingdom. How often do we pray that? How often do we pray, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus. And I understand some of us, we don't pray that because we know that we have loved ones who are lost and that aren't ready for Jesus Christ's return. But deep down in us, we should have this prayer, God, I pray that you would come. Bring about the kingdom here in this world, Father. And because when we look at the world and we look at the brokenness all around us, you read the headlines, you watch the headlines, and we see that we live in a broken world, tainted by sin. All of us affected by sin in so many different ways, with death and hurt and sickness all around us, and pain and suffering. And so because of that, we should look around and we should say, God, I pray that your kingdom would come. A kingdom when there's going to be no more heartache. A kingdom when there's going to be no more tears, no more suffering. God, I pray that your kingdom would come. That's a powerful prayer, but how often do we pray it? God, I pray that you bring about the full consummation of your kingdom. And then, this is an even harder prayer. God, help me. God, use me to help bring about your kingdom. Yes, you pray that your kingdom would come, but it's not like, God, I pray that others would do that and you would work and I could just sit back and do nothing. It's a prayer saying, God, use me, whatever that means, whether it's out sharing the gospel, out encouraging the sick, doing whatever we can to say, God, I pray that your kingdom would come. Use me. And here's the thing, as the kingdom of God forcefully advances, we should expect opposition. As the kingdom of God spreads and it comes into contact with the kingdom of Satan, the kingdom of this world, we should expect opposition. Because for the kingdom of God to come and to move and advance, all other kingdoms must fade into oblivion. It's an all or nothing with the kingdom of God. Think about the early Christians. They were living in the days of the Roman Empire. And what did Caesar require? Caesar required that the people, all the citizens, would make this declaration that Caesar is Lord. But the early Christians, they couldn't do that. Many of them went to their death because they would not say Caesar is Lord, because they knew that Jesus was Lord. They weren't going to submit to the kingdom of Caesar. They were going to commit only to the kingdom of their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Fast forward several years to World War II and to Nazi Germany. A lot of the Christians there, they were forced to renounce Jesus as Lord. Why? Because the Nazis and the Germans, they wanted the people to believe that Hitler was Lord. And so many Christians went to concentration camps. Yes, we talk about the Jews, but also Christians went as well because they were unwilling to submit to Hitler as Lord, because they knew Jesus Christ was Lord. And brothers and sisters and friends, we are living in a day and a culture where confessing Jesus Christ is not only uncool, yes, it's uncool increasingly more, but also to confess Jesus as Lord is to come into direct confrontation with the culture and the powers that be, and it's only going to get worse. And we've seen it increase so rapidly just over the past 10 years. It's a subversive prayer, but yet we pray. Not only do we pray, we live it out. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, bring about your kingdom. One writer writes and he says, thus when we pray, your kingdom come, we are praying something incredibly dangerous because it imperils our comfort and devalues our ease. By praying your kingdom come, Jesus teaches us that we are ultimately meant to value God's agenda, not our own. By making God's kingdom paramount in our hearts, we are setting aside our own paltry attempts to personal glory to pursue the glory of King Jesus. When we pray, Our desire should be that God, that King Jesus would be exalted, that he'd be hallowed, that he would be glorified. And that will affect the way that everything we say after that, every request we make after that, if it comes through that filter and that lens, will change the way that we pray as a people. I truly believe that. So number one, we should pray for God's name to be hallowed or to be glorified. Number two, we should pray for God's kingdom to come. And finally, number three, we should pray for God's will to be done. And this is the third request that Jesus makes relating to his Father. Pray that God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And of course, this request builds on the previous request connected to the kingdom, because if we want the kingdom of God to spread, then the will of God must be obeyed and submitted to and surrendered to and honored. And because Jesus prays for God's will to be done, it means that God's will is not always obeyed. That's interesting for us to think about. But to help us better understand this, how God's will cannot be obeyed, we need to look at a couple of different wills that are found in the Bible. The first one is this, is God's sovereign will, or sometimes called the will, God's will of decree. See, God sovereignly rules over everything, all things, creation. And if God sovereignly rules or decides or chooses to do something, it's going to happen, undoubtedly. And for example, God willed for the heavens and the earth to be created back in Genesis 1, and it happened. God willed for his Son, before the creation of the world, it was God's will that his Son would come and die on the cross. He would die for the sins of the world. It came about. No, nobody or nothing was going to thwart that, was going to stop that. Psalm 115:3 says, but our God is in heaven, he does whatever he pleases. That's his sovereign will, choosing what he does and coming and taking place. But then the second will is God's moral will, or sometimes called God's will of desire. It's what should be done. And sometimes people talk about the commandments of God related to this particular will. Because if God's moral will, his desire is for us to be honest, well, sometimes we're not honest. We lie. We deceive. We're dishonest. So we see that God's moral way, his desire, isn't always obeyed, isn't always followed. Now I'll give you an example of this, how these two kind of interact and operate with one another. If you think about God's will and God as a cruise ship, a cruise liner. If you think about God's sovereign will is like that captain on that cruise line. And he steered that boat and that ship, and he's taking it wherever he wants to. If he wants to turn around, turn right, he turns right. If he wants to do circles, he does circles. But then you think about the moral will, you've got so many different passengers on that particular cruise liner. And they're on vacation, so some of them, they might want to go and have a buffet breakfast. Some of them say, you know what, I might go out and lounge around the pool. Some of them say, I might want to go sing karaoke or videoke, and they'd be Filipinos because they love videoke. But they make such different choices all along that ship. But ultimately, God's sovereign will is directing that ship where he ultimately wants it to go. So when we pray that God's will be done in our own lives, God's moral will, we pray that that people would obey God's moral will. We pray that for our own lives, thy will be done, that we would obey God's will, but that others would also do that as well. And what is Jesus? He makes this clarification, this connection, on earth as it is in heaven. What's he meaning? Well, in heaven, God's will is completely obeyed. It's always obeyed. And we know that there was one who didn't obey his will, and he got kicked out, and that was Satan. But in heaven, God's will is always obeyed and surrendered to. And Jesus said, you know what? I pray that everybody on earth, that you created people here on this earth, they would surrender and submit to your will on earth as they are surrendering and submitting to your will in heaven. And so, brothers and sisters, this is one of the reasons why we share the gospel to the lost. Because when God's kingdom comes into the hearts of men, when they hear the gospel that Jesus died in their place and he rose back to life and he offers the free gift of salvation by grace through faith, that when they're converted, when they come into the faith, when they come into the kingdom of God, then what do? Then they surrender and obey God's will in their lives. And that's why we must continue to share with God. Not only, of course, God commands us to do that, but also we want to see God's kingdom come in the hearts of all those around us. And ultimately, at glorification, the believers will ultimately surrender and completely obey God's will in their life. But until then, we pray for ourselves. We pray for others. That they would completely surrender to God's will. And so that this is foundational. Before we make any prayers for ourselves or others in our life, before we move to the horizontal, we need to realize, we need to pray this prayer. God, I pray that your will would be done in my life and the lives of others. God, help me. Help me to line up my will with your will. Amy Carmichael, a missionary to India, she said, "And shall I pray to change my will, my Father, until it accord to mine? But no, Lord, no, that shall never be. Rather, I pray that you would blend my human will with yours. Take my will, our will, which doesn't always line up with God, and then what? Make it align with God's will." And so all prayer willingly submits to God's purposes, his plans, but also his glory. This means that God is not just some genie in a bottle, right? We all know the story. You rub the genie, rub the bottle, and the genie comes out. And then he gives you three wishes. Sometimes we go to prayer like that. We go to God, here's my wishes. Or we talk about God as a vending machine. We go up to the vending machine, we look at the choice, we say, okay, what do I want? This is what I want a Mountain Dew, or I want a Dr. Pepper, or I want a Coke, or I want some cheesy fries. But God's not some vending machine that we go up and choose what we want. We come to prayer asking God, what is your will? What is your will for me in this situation? What is your will for the others in my life? I just read recently on Facebook, I think Cindy might have posted it. It was a quote from Elizabeth Elliot, and it says this: "To pray thy will be done, I must be willing. If the answer requires it, that my will be undone." And I think sometimes one of the best things about prayer, we don't think of it like this, when we come before God, our loving Father, but also this holy God, when we come before him, one of the best things that prayer does for us is it causes our will to be undone, causes us for us to check our will and say, God, is this desire of mine? Is this selfish? Or is this truly a godly desire that you have placed in me? And this is going to require us to pray that prayer that God, that your will be done, will cause us to set aside so many of our selfish or fleshly desires so that, God, we can truly ask you, what would you have done? What would you have me do in this situation? And so what we see here, these three things, three ways that we should pray, is they focus on God, and we should pray for God's name to be glorified. We should pray for God's kingdom to come, and we should pray for God's will to be done in our lives, but also in the lives of others. And we will see next week that it's okay, it's good and acceptable to pray for yourself, to pray for others, but we must first make sure that the first things are first, that the priority is placed in the right place, because prayer must focus on God's glory, God's kingdom, and God's will. And if we miss those three things, then we're going to miss the heart of prayer. We're going to miss the purpose of prayer. And notice this, and I'm going to wrap up with this right here. Notice how Jesus ends his prayer, ends the Lord's Prayer. Now, I didn't read it, but I will read it for you now. Look at the way he says. Most of us know this. We can quote this. He says, "For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Prayer from beginning to end is about God. Yes, it's to God, But it's about him. It's about his glory. It's about his kingdom. It's about his will being submitted to and obeyed. And if we miss this, that's why I call it the heart of prayer. If we miss that prayer is first and foremost and last but not least about God, then we'll miss the purpose of prayer and its effectiveness in our own life. But prayer from beginning to end is about God. And once God is then given proper place, proper priority, proper focus in our prayers, that'll help us in the rest of our life, help put God in the right center, the right focus. But then once we do that, then we can start making requests for ourselves and for those around us. And we'll pick up there next week. I pray that you'll join us. I pray the weather will cooperate and we'll be able to join together next week as we finish off the Lord's Prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this prayer that your Son Jesus has given to us as a model, God, because we need to know. Prayer is such an important thing. We need to know how best to pray, how you would want us to pray, Father. If you've created prayer, if you've given prayer to us, then it's you who is best able to tell us how we are to pray. So God, I pray today and even the days to come that you would continue to teach us to pray. And that when you teach us, we wouldn't just have this as head knowledge, but that we would be a people of prayer. Yeah. That's my prayer, God. That this year, 2022, that we would be individuals of prayer, that we'd be families of prayer, that we would be a church of prayer. And God, that you would use that to honor your name, to glorify your name, God. You would use that to bring about your kingdom. You'd use that. God, use us not only to obey your will, but to see your will obeyed in the lives of others. God, so that's our prayer. Help us in this. In your Son's name I pray. Amen. We're going to have a song of invitation. Brother Greg is going to sing us another song, Kneel at the Cross. What a great reminder that God calls us to kneel before him in prayer. Kneel at the cross. And it's going to go on right now.
Jesus will meet you.
We're so grateful that you've joined us online today, whether watching it live or maybe catching it later. We truly know that the enemy's been at work. Just as I said, what a powerful message about, not because I preached it, but because Jesus prayed it, focusing on the kingdom of God and how we pray that God's kingdom would expand and move amongst those in our lives and those in our community. It's a message that Satan didn't want it to go out. But we're going to continue to be faithful. And you'll see here on the screen here, if you need prayer, you need someone to talk to, maybe you say, David, you know what, I sense the Spirit convicting me. Or you may say, David, you know what, I'm not a follower of Jesus Christ. I'm not a part of God's kingdom. I don't regularly submit. I cannot submit to God's will in my life. I pray that you just text ABC to this number here, and we'll make sure that you get prayed for, that you get contacted, and I'm also available at any time as well. Again, pray that you all stay warm and that you stay safe. And Lord willing, we'll be right here the same time, same place next week, 10:30 next Sunday, as we finish up our series on the Lord's Prayer. Take care and God bless.